Books on Tape presents Queen Bee Moms and Kingpin Dads by Rosalind Wiseman, read by Lee Adams. Introduction. How did it get to be back to school night again already? You can't believe another school year has begun so soon. Your daughter just started middle school, and you're excited to meet her teachers and hear what the principal has to say. But meeting the faculty is only a small part of the evening. You're embarrassed to admit it. But first you have to figure out what to wear. You want to look put together, but you don't want to look like you're trying too hard. Should you dress more professionally? Maybe something more casual. Maybe jeans. But what if you're not taken seriously enough? Three changes of clothes later, you walk into the main entrance. Where are all your friends? Everyone else is saying hello and doing the usual catching up. Well, not everyone. There are always those couples scattered around who never say anything. They all seem to be hugging the wall near the refreshment table. Why did you have to get here so early? Uh-oh, there's that woman you had the run-in with last spring when your kids both tried out for the travel soccer team. Oh, no, you tell your spouse. She's the one who screamed at the coach because her daughter didn't make the cut. I asked her to cool it, and she totally went off on me. You round the corner quickly before she sees you. Oh, look, there's the PTA sign-up desk. All the power moms, the movers and shakers on the school board, the PTA president and vice president, and the rest of the tightly knit group are staffing the table, trying to recruit new families and encourage everyone to pay their dues. They're greeting some parents incredibly warmly. They're distant to others. They give you polite smiles, but the message is, we don't know you. You're not one of the doobies. We're reserving judgment. At the next table, another team of women is aggressively recruiting for various committees. You look around. No fathers seem to be manning these desks. We could really use some help on the authors and artists event, calls out one of the moms. May we sign you up? I'm not sure, you say. Work has just been incredibly crazy, and I don't know. Oh, that's okay. We understand, she replies, her demeanor cooling instantly. I work too. So does everyone else on the committee. That's code for, hey, we all work hard. We're just not afraid to work harder for our kids. Clearly, we're more dedicated parents than you. There's Carly's mom, Denise. Carly and your Katie used to be such good friends, but lately things have cooled off. Carly didn't even call Katie back when she got home from sleepaway camp. Katie's hurt, but you're not really sure how to handle it. Denise is a little intense. Hi, Denise trills. How was your summer? Carly had a blast at the John Hopkins Lit thing. We went to space camp, too. How'd Katie do on that Odyssey paper? Carly had trouble with it at first, but I helped her out on the research, and I think Mrs. Evans is definitely going to want her for the GATE class. Was there a mailing you missed? Is your daughter going to be shut out of the gifted class because you buried some assignment in the foot-tall stack of old mail on the hall table? Odyssey paper, you ask weakly. Denise's eyes widen. Katie didn't do the Odyssey paper yet? They went over it last week at the GATE meeting. I was wondering why you weren't there. Oh, my God, we missed it, you say. Do you think it's too late? Katie should totally be in GATE. Denise smiles soothingly. Don't worry. Just talk to Rochelle. Rochelle. So Denise is on a first-name basis with the principal. You're not even sure how to spell her last name. As Denise disappears into the crowd, a smiling mother holds out a flyer to you with one hand. In the other, she's holding a clipboard and a stack of papers. It's about the new Kendall McGee rubric. We think the principal is on completely the wrong track with the new curriculum. Did you have any questions before you signed the petition? You have no idea what she's talking about. But you don't want to ask. You don't want to look like a clueless parent. Let me just get back to you on this, you say, as the lights begin to flicker on and off. Looks like they want us inside the auditorium. On the way, you pass the principal. She's already surrounded by parents who are hugging her and saying, "So, Rochelle, how was your summer? That suit looks fabulous." Inside the auditorium, there are more knots of parents getting reacquainted after a summer apart. It's immediately obvious which parents are new to the school. you and your spouse take one of the few remaining spaces up front. "I'm sorry," says a mother, smiling past your shoulder. "We're saving those." You apologize, blushing. You didn't know. You've been at school 10 minutes, and already you've flunked. Why are you worrying about what you're going to wear to back-to-school night like a 14-year-old before a school dance? And when and why did back-to-school night become a barometer for your own parenting and popularity? Let's face it, being a parent brings out our most nurturing, mature side, but it also taps our deepest insecurities, makes us question our every ability, and causes us to measure ourselves against everyone around us. In other words, it makes us feel like seventh graders all over again. When I wrote my first book, Queen Bees and Wannabes, I wanted to help parents help their daughters survive and thrive in what I call girl world, the social hierarchy where queen bees, messengers, and bankers, and their male counterparts, play pivotal and often corrupting parts in children's lives. My intention was to help parents decode girl and boy world so they would understand what their children are going through and could get advice on how to help their kids help themselves. As I traveled all over the country and spoke to hundreds of parents, I learned that parents are also looking for another type of help. They want to know how to deal with the unspoken rules of perfect parent world, that mythical kingdom where all the other, presumably perfect parents live and rule, a world with a social hierarchy uncannily similar to that of girl and boy world. It's a world in which a few parents set the rules for all parental involvement. The standards are virtually impossible to achieve, and most parents feel frustrated or disempowered, including the parents who established the rules in the first place. It's a world that convinces parents to make decisions based on their fear of other people's judgments and leaves them struggling over whether and how much to get involved in their children's schools and social lives. In this world, many parents compete ruthlessly through their children, while other parents fear to speak out against them. And it has all of us reliving the traumas and dilemmas of our own youth, even as we're surprised to learn that those decades-old obsessions have returned or are still alive, if indeed they ever disappeared entirely. In Queen Bees and Wannabes, I argued that the seemingly innocuous rites of passage that are dismissed with phrases like "girls will be girls," "gossip," "cliques," "competition for social status," teach girls how power and privilege work in our culture. I discussed how the boys will be boys mentality likewise teaches boys that might makes right. Both boys and girls too often learn to be silent in the face of injustice. It doesn't matter if that lesson is learned by a 10-year-old boy who is relentlessly teased by being called gay, or by a junior girl who thinks it's so important to be popular that she's willing to be physically tortured by other girls in a hazing ritual, or by a parent who doesn't think she can confront another parent about her child's cruel behavior. These experiences teach everyone involved that whoever has power and privilege in our society is permitted to do what they want to people who don't. If we don't confront this power system, or if we buy into it ourselves, we can come across as unethical or cowardly and undermine our ability to teach our children a true moral foundation and feeling of responsibility to their community. As the co-founder of the Empower Program, an organization dedicated to educating teens about the culture of violence, I work with more than 10,000 boys and girls and their parents, teachers, school administrators, coaches, and counselors every year. Here's what I've learned. Every queen bee girl or dominator boy is hatched from a hive. The first lessons our children learn in creating their own social hierarchies are the ones they glean from us and the culture at large. The first step toward helping our kids cope with bullying in any form is recognizing the degree to which we're still immersed in those same battles for power. I've written this book to give you, as parents, a different kind of power with your own children, other parents and their children, teachers and administrators. Power that is respectful of children's needs and desires and that changes their world for the good. Power that gives you the ability to look at your own behavior without beating yourself up and to understand how you can more effectively work with with the other adults in your child.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.